Somos más, police officers and such weren't as violent as they generally would have been with a protest that was mixed, male and female. With the women, they were a little bit more concerned with how they acted. They didn't want to show so much violence, although they did in one case that when there was one man in the film, they grabbed him right away. But towards the end, they were throwing tear gas at the women and also using fire hoses on them, which I'm sure was, you know, very painful. But I think they had a lot of restraint considering that they were women.
¿Cuál es la finalidad y el objetivo de esta marcha?
Mostrar que somos más y que estamos por la unidad y la solidaridad entre los chilenos.
Seguramente todos ustedes saben y el resto lo sabe. ¿Para qué lo van a...?
In 1973, the democratically elected government of Salvador Allende Grossens was overthrown by General Augusto Pinochet, who formed a military government. Many years of brutal repression followed. Thousands disappeared and were murdered. Today, the country is still ruled by the military, and the repression, although more subtle, continues.
The women were holding their hands up in the air, and the direct translation is saying that our hands are clean. What they're implying is that we are innocent. We have no blood on our hands. You are the murderers. How can you harass us or arrest us? Which I thought was interesting, the way that they said it.
Vamos, vamos. A ver, aquí.
I think this film is a positive force in the Chilean struggle. It lets some Americans know what's going on over there. And even though it's not shown in Chile, if it gets shown here, maybe we can help them. Maybe we can do something about it, at least become aware.
Olhar Eletrônico started to do some exhibitions in São Paulo in 82. And nowadays, those exhibitions are running through other states of Brazil. We don't have so much space on TV, so we have festivals, we have some other space who allow us to show our products for the audience. But I believe our main purpose is to go to the networks, is to show these tapes through the air, because you know, you don't have that audience just showing your programs in galleries or in festivals. So I believe those places are good to meet people and to keep contact and to exchange ideas. But our main purpose in Olhar Eletrônico is to make programs for TV. Arlene Normal is a tape with 6 minutes of duration. It's a fiction. We were wondering about how is the day of a regular secretary, executive secretary in a big city. So we made up a screen, a script, wondering what kind of things a regular person do since he wake up until he go to bed. So this is Marlee Normal. This is a Marlee, a girl, Normal, a regular girl. Marlee Normal was conceived by Fernando and Marcelo Machado. They would like to have a soundtrack which could show how the ordinary things that we made during the day, that we make during the day, are so, you know, timed. So they decide to put this soundtrack with a sort of divided mathematic, the soundtrack. This kind of noise that keep whole time in Marlee Normal. And also the editing is very, very fragmented. And it's very mathematical fragmented. So they went to the editing machine and they did a sort of mathematic calculations and they came up with this Marlee Normal.
Duvido que ele tenha tanto amor e até os erros do meu português ruim. E nessa hora você vai.
I believe Marlee Normal is a tape about any girl in any big city of the world. So the Brazilians' reaction was, it's a sort of strange editing, it's a sort of strange music, and it's very fast, and suddenly it stops, and you stay watching a door for, you know, for 30 seconds, and it's very frightening, it's very, you know, it's very boring, and suddenly Marlene Normal starts walking. So they decide to do this sort of counterpoint editing, and it works quite well, I believe.
Hasta Vencer, Until Victory, is a documentary produced by the Ictus Theater Group, which follows for 1 year the birth and development of a squatter's village outside of Santiago. The housing crisis in Chile has become so great that thousands of once middle-class families have lost their homes. This tape tries to provide hope for those left homeless by showing them what can be accomplished by working together with other homeless people.
And the colonists, if you want to call them that, or the occupiers of the space, apparently requested a hearing with the authorities to present their case. And I was particularly struck with the manner in which they had done it, and the presentations that the people made to try to justify the reasoning behind their being there, and how much they could support or couldn't support based on their earnings. The authorities were very negative. The authorities in this tape were only represented by one army officer who simply was going through an exercise whereby he was saying that under no conditions could the place be tolerated, and that the government was preparing places outside the city in a more remote area where they would be, to which they could be moved, and in which they would have good houses and good support and so forth. But it was obvious that the people did not believe him, and they therefore decided to return to their community and make it go.
A partir nosotros planteamos de quedarnos dentro de la comuna, dentro del área metropolitana. Por los familiares que están acá cerca, tenemos lugares donde trabajar, donde realizar algunos pololos.
Estamos trazando aquí porque para hallar el campamento en tránsito. Estamos trazando el sitio de 4x5, ya para que ubicar bien a la gente y ordenar al campamento.
Después tenemos el problema sanitario, y que se está canalizando a través de los policlínicos de los sectores, donde se exige, ¿no es cierto?, la limpieza. Entonces, a través de eso, el problema de salud se está controlando y en cada sector se detectan estas cosas e inmediatamente se informa al policlínico central.
Con su urgencia aquí en caseta de transmisiones.
Esta posta de primeros auxilios o policlínico funciona algunos días con médicos, que son médicos voluntarios de distintas instituciones.
Estamos también porque hoy día es el último día que hay en la olla común, porque no tenemos alimentación.
Bueno, aquí la olla está organizada porque salimos a pedir a las ferias. A veces hay o a veces no hay. De alguna manera tenemos que salir para la olla aquí para los niños.
¿Cuántas personas comen de esta
olla? Aquí estarán comiendo sus 150 personas ahora, porque se les ha quitado. A los que están trabajando se les quita la olla, se les da preferencia al cesante.
Esto es por el año aniversario que tenemos en el campamento. ¿Ah?
Todos los chilenos deben celebrar este magnífico acontecimiento. Un año de vida de esta toma, que ha sido uno de los éxitos más grandes de compañeros de chilenos sin casa, que lograron con voluntad, con tesón, con esfuerzo, vencer la oposición que el gobierno les puso para mantenerse, para tomar esto primero y después para mantenerse en el campamento. Creemos que ellos han dado un ejemplo a todos los pobladores. Esa es la forma de resolver hoy por hoy el problema habitacional en la medida que se puede de los pobladores. No hay otra.
Nuestra lucha, ¿no es cierto?, va a fructificar. No solo la nuestra, sino que van a venir más adelante, ¿no es cierto? Van a seguir viniendo posteriores tomas, quizás. Y quizás en una de esas van a estar ustedes. Y a ustedes les decimos que necesitamos ahora, en este momento, su apoyo solidario. Quizás no tanto lo material, sino lo espiritual. El saber que ustedes están junto a nosotros.
Yo creo que la situación de la mujer en el Perú y en el mundo es una situación bastante desventajosa con respecto a la del hombre. Si queremos hacer del problema de la mujer un problema genérico.
I believe that the situation of women in Peru and in the world is one with many disadvantages when compared to the situation of men. In Miss Universe in Peru's case, what we tried to do is to show that there is misuse of women's beauty. The beauty that we see in magazines is not the conception of beauty that we as Peruvian women perceive.
Y donde hay el mal uso de lo que es la belleza de la mujer, la belleza tal cual la vemos en la publicidad, en las revistas, y que no es el concepto de belleza que nosotros como grupo manejamos.
Estamos en un congreso y estamos queriendo ir adelante, haciendo ver y consiguiendo nuestras reivindicaciones, porque nosotros en realidad no somos bellezas. Y además de eso, estas mujeres están exhibiéndose como un animal. Entonces, compañeros, lo que ahora nosotros estamos buscando es simplemente nuestros derechos como mujeres, que también valemos igual que el hombre, y siempre somos explotadas. En el campo, el hombre gana más plata y la mujer la mitad, compañeros.
La cantidad de público, banderas, la presencia de la Guardia Republicana que le ha dado un matiz de jerarquía muy especial a este desfile, la presencia de autoridades. Creo que esto puede ser un lindo comienzo, por decir así, Patria, pero por sobre todas las cosas, destacando el respeto que nos merece la mujer en línea general, ¿eh? Que todos la respetemos y que apreciemos no solamente sus virtudes físicas, sino que podamos comprender todo ese proceso de evolución que se inicia en la niñez, que sigue en la adolescencia, que genera su madurez y que finalmente, pues se transforma en mujer, mujer de hogar, madre de familia, y el periodo que tiene que cumplir de acuerdo a la vida.
Después de terminar de repartir los volantes, ya en la retirada, me quedé parada bien roto el corso, vinieron tres policías a cogerme por sorpresa con la intención de pegarme. Es ahí donde nosotros, ante nuestra negativa a entrar patrullero y que nos llevaran detenidas, hicimos un forcejeo y la policía comienza a darnos a varazos, a puntapiés, y comienza a arrastrarnos. Entonces tuvimos que defendernos también a golpes, ¿no? O sea, a puntapiés, arañazos y todo eso.
Miss Universe in Peru is a movie that was developed during the actual filming. In other words, the film, the things that we were seeing day by day, the process that was the making of this pageant, is the actual screenplay. A screenplay developed day by day, taking into account the actual happenings. To confront the economic difficulties which face all Latin American independent producers, Peru's filmmakers created a form of union. Grupo Chasqui was created in 1982 when independent producers pooled their resources. Their objective is to make a national cinema that gives a voice to the marginal sectors of Peruvian society. One of their productions, Miss Universe in Peru, documents the contest and its relation to real life for women in Peru.
Today, what I'm doing is I'm showing tapes from the L.A.V.A. archive in various classes, and so that the teachers of the classes can understand ways that they can integrate the tapes from the archive into their curriculums. Today I'm showing tapes in a communications class, and I'm showing tapes in a writing class in English, and I'm showing tapes in a theater class. And the point being that a lot of teachers in the Spanish department or Latin American studies, they understand right away how they can use these tapes because they're about Latin America. But the tapes have a lot more uses, and teachers have to see that, though, in their classes before they really understand how to use them. I hear that you're going to start talking about religious television in the United States next week. And obviously, religion plays a big factor in Nicaraguan life, as it does in the rest of South America. And there's a lot of struggle going on in the church in Nicaragua, part of the church that supports the government and part of the church that doesn't support the government. The Sweating Virgin, also produced by SSTV, is a made-for-TV drama based on a real incident. Uncle Sam is displeased by the unity he sees being formed by the revolutionary government and the Catholic Church. He comes up with a plan to convince the population of God's displeasure with the Sandinista government.
No, no poder ser posible lo que ver. No. Y ahora, ¿qué hacer? Sandinistas están metidos con la religión. ¿Cómo ser posible? ¿Qué hacer? ¿Qué hacer? Ya.
Lo que podemos hacer es pedir ayuda a Miss Prensia. Ella sí puede manejar estas cosas. Ella sí, mi señor. Es la única que puede ayudarnos en estos momentos. Eso es, mi señor. Eso es.
¿Me hablaba, mi señor? Aquí estoy. Soy todo para usted.
¿Cómo ser posible? No haber hecho tú tampoco nada por Nicaragua. Esta situación ser grave. No soportarla.
Pero, señor, lo hemos intentado todo. Todo lo que usted nos ha dicho, lo hemos hecho.
Eso te voy a pedir aquí. A ver, con cuidadito, ¿viste?
Mira, ahí no se ve. Eso es. Mira, ahí lo he hecho. Mira.
Ahí, sí, sí.
Ahí.
Un poquito más adelante.
Ahí. Ya.
Ahí
está. Bueno,
Here's the unabridged explanation of how Deep Dish TV gets to you. It starts with thousands of producers making programs within their communities nationwide. They send their shows to coordinating producers, each in a different region working on a different show. All the edited shows are sent to Deep Dish Central in New York, where we coordinate the network. We take it to an uplink, which sends it to a satellite, which sends its beam back down to this hemisphere in a pattern called a footprint. Cable systems receive the signal in the dish and send it out to their subscribers on a public access channel, through the cable system to your house, to your TV, to your eyes. Deep Dish is a unique network because it isn't driven by profit or religion. We won't try to sell you anything. Public access is a vital component of our First Amendment rights. Stay tuned to Deep Dish and see Fearless TV.
Today, most of the information you get from films, from television, from magazines or newspapers are controlled by only 29 corporations. With so many millions of dollars driving these corporations, how can you or I or any other individual be fairly represented in the media? But there is an alternative. Public access offers a unique opportunity to express yourself and explore important issues in your community. There are over 1,500 public access systems nationwide. You're probably watching this show on one right now. It's available on a first-come, first-served basis. So call your local cable system to find out how you can get involved. It's a vital component of our First Amendment rights in the information age. So use it or lose it. What do you think, guys?
You flubbed it, though.
One more.
No, you're supposed to say, stay tuned to Deep Dish TV.
The way that I got involved in L.A.V.A. is I had been working as a journalist in Latin America and became aware that there was a growing popular video movement happening, which meant this new video technology of cheaper, smaller cameras were getting into the hands of people, Indians, women's groups, labor unions, church groups, all kinds of people were beginning to make their own television. And I thought it was important to try and bring that work back to the United States. Because after working as a journalist, I realized that the information that Americans were getting about Latin America came from the perspective of the North American journalists who were down there making the news reports.
This project has several different elements, and I think one of the things that we have done working with really three project consultants is to involve students in three different aspects of the archives. One aspect was to acquire new materials that had not yet been translated and subtitled, and to involve students in this actual process of translating and doing the subtitling. So they're learning communication skills, technical skills, language skills, as well as knowledge about Latin America.
If we put these and then put the number 12 in years, were painful, I think it fits.
I'm here because I'm a woman, because these 12 years have been painful, because I'm for unity and solidarity of all Chileans.
I've noticed a lot of times when we translate like idiomatic expressions that sometimes they don't come out with a meaning that other people are going to understand, that's going to confuse people, so that we have to change it around. A lot of times it's different. And also with the language, like Elisa was talking before, you could say one word, like the word bato, you could say it and it'll mean duck. You say it again, it'll mean a fag. So, you know, you could be talking to someone and say, oh, look at that duck, and they could think you're talking about, if there's a person there, they think you're saying that person's gay or something.
Hi, my name is Shalom Garowitz, and this is Franz Vila, and we're professors at Ramapo College, and we're going to be talking about the Latin American video art that's part of the Latin American video archives here at Ramapo College. Video art grew out of several art movements that were happening in the 1950s and 60s, including the experiments in art and technology, and the work of groups like the Fluxus Group that was interested in the dematerialization of the art object and of taking the art out of museums and galleries and making them more accessible to the citizens of the society. Nam June Paik was a member of that group, and he was one of the first to begin to explore different configurations of the television monitors, of running a magnet around the tube to distort the images. Peter Campus was working at public television stations with special effects to uncover structural qualities of the medium. William Wegman would take small format porta packs, black and white porta packs, and turn them on himself and on his dog Monray to make conceptual skits that were often humorous and also very serious from an artistic point of view.
While all this happening was taking place in the United States, basically, but also in Europe too, video art was building its own language that is coming from television language, that is related to the language of movies, and that enriched with the development of computer graphics. At this point, we can talk about some kind of electronic perception that during all this time has been developing, and more artists and more audiences are becoming aware of the electronic perception. This electronic perception produced the tech art, video art is precisely part of this tech art. And it's tech art basically because for the first time in history, video artists are the only ones who not just approach technology, but produce technological items and technological pieces. And their work is absolutely electronic, and it's technological artwork. That's two important elements in the comprehension of video art, its language and its perception. Now, the audiences that we have in video art are coming from television and also are coming from visual arts, people who are been following up performances and visual arts in general.
Video art's early utopian goal was to realize Marshall McLuhan's idea that the world had become a global village, that through television, computer, satellite technology, we were all more and more interconnected through this web of information. As video equipment has become more available and accessible, more and more people are using it for personal expression, for community activism, and to participate in an international dialogue about theories such as postmodernism and simulationism. There have emerged several artists of international stature, like Bill Viola, Mary Lucier, and in England, Jeremy Welsh. There are very important festivals happening throughout the world, Australia, Holland, France, Germany, United States, and there's one in Colombia, South America. These are gathering places for the exchange of information about technology, about new concepts that are making this a very quickly evolving new artistic medium.
The history of art video in Latin America really starts at the end of the 70s, in the late 70s. Even though we have in 1972 in Brazil the group Olar Electronics, and later in 1982 the group Chasque in Peru. But video really doesn't develop in Latin America until the moment when porta packs are available for consumers. So then the artists start experimenting. It's a very important difference here in the perception of Latin American video art, and is that video art in these countries is collective. We don't have really personalities that we could highlight in this moment. We had basically groups that experiment with the technology, groups that experiment also with the language, Groups that try to have any specific participation in the whole process of Latin American history. So we are facing in this moment a different kind of aesthetics. It's aesthetics of collective, and it's aesthetic very structured with the socio-political going on in Latin America. Video also maybe lends its language from television. Television in Latin America, as you know, most of the people know already, is owned by the government and was introduced to these countries in the late 50s as an instructional tool in order to help education campaigns, etc. But later becomes commercial, and the artists start criticizing this influence of television and trying to use the media for purposes, focuses mostly in the social developments of these countries.
So Franz, what do you think the future holds for Latin American video art?
The future of video in Latin America depends on the relations with the United States, basically, and European countries. I mean, relations in terms of economical ties and also technological ties. One of the problems in Latin America is the lack of developing their own technology and their own economy. So they are dependent countries from practically United States and some European countries also. The format that has been used most of the time, I mean, through the whole history of video art in Latin America, has been beta. And the access to Betamax has been very important for all the video artists in Latin America. Also, they have been used the three-quarter format, the U-matic. And I think that many of them should be opening their eyes to the Super VHS. Of course, we have no idea if this format could be useful in Latin America. Also, we know Beta is coming with the VHS system that is as well as good as Super VHS. This is just in regarding the technology. Regarding the ideas, I guess Latin American artists are creating and building up a language that before has been not very clear for other countries and other cultures, but it's very clear for Latin American artists, you know, the collective aesthetics.
I guess it's curious that in the United States there are several expatriate South Americans, Edine Velez from Puerto Rico, Teo Maus from Mexico, and Juan Downey from Chile, who are still very involved in expressing issues of Latin American political situation in their work.
Yeah. It's true, and it's kind of obvious. Many intellectuals are out of Latin America. Even though there's few democracies in Latin America, in fact, they are not democracies at all. I mean, the military, they have tremendous power in all these countries, and the violence and the political struggle is everyday life in Latin America. They are very afraid of any kind of approach to the Latin American history and situation, and intellectuals are in that group of people that they feel scared and they want to get rid of them. But within Latin America and outside Latin American artists, well-known artists like Fernando Botero in painting, you know, are very critical of Latin American situations. Also, Gabriel Garcia Marquez, and we know also his work, and many other writers and painters and video artists like Juan Downey and the others you mentioned.
Salvador Media Project was founded in 1982 to distribute films and media from El Salvador and it was founded by Salvadorans and by concerned U.S. citizens.
Why was the group formed?
We felt that there was a need to bring to the United States, to the people of the United States, the message of the Salvadoran people, because the level of involvement of the United States in El Salvador and Latin America in general is so high, and we felt that people did not really know the level of involvement of the United States in El Salvador. So to bring the message of the people to the United States, the message of the people of El Salvador to the United States was important as part of the process of searching for a self-determination, the self-determination of the people of El Salvador. The main characteristic of this media is the collective nature of its production. It presents history of El Salvador as lived collectively by the people of El Salvador. And one of the reasons might be, I think, the fact that these tapes and this media and these films are produced collectively by the filmmakers. In some cases, it's very difficult for the filmmakers, the people who have the cameras, to have connections with the editors. Maybe they are in different places, or maybe someone has a camera in the west side of the country, and the other one has a camera on the east side of the country, and maybe they never meet each other. Sometimes they will meet at the beginning, before they start producing, and they will discuss the situation in El Salvador, and usually people who never see each other have a consensus of what's going on in El Salvador, what's the political situation in El Salvador. So they will film things, and when everything comes together, there will be discussions with among the editors, among the producers, among the people who are participating in this process, who have nothing to do with the filmmaking, but who are an important part of the process, the social process in El Salvador. And this is how the collective production comes about. And I think it's very important, because in the United States especially, people tend to personalize things and to bring them to a different level that does not correspond with the reality in El Salvador.
Que está aquí en medio del control que nosotros tenemos, se puede decir, pues está tranquila, porque se siente segura, porque tenemos vigilancia alrededor aquí. Bueno, ellos, pues ahí está la prueba, están comercio y todo, está normal. Pues, no es más que, pues sí, por allá tenemos las líneas de juego y la gente tiene confianza. Ninguna intervención nos va a derrotar, ¿verdad? Lo que estamos haciendo, pues, nos estamos preparando, estamos conscientes de eso, pues, ¿verdad? Que el enemigo, cuando se siente derrotado, pues sí, aquí la oligarquía, aquí el ejército nacional, se sienta derrotado, claro, tenía que buscar ayuda exterior, ¿verdad? Porque los norteamericanos aquí tienen interés, entonces ellos tienen que defenderlo. Entonces, ya nosotros ya estamos... prevenido, se puede decir, ya nos imaginábamos que eso tenía que suceder, ¿verdad? Entonces estamos preparados para esa intervención. No nos van a desmoralizar porque vengan aviones o buques de guerra o que hagan todo volar, ¿verdad? No nos van a desmoralizar porque sabemos que es el pueblo el que está ganando la guerra y por lo tanto otro ejército no lo puede venir a derrotar, ¿verdad?
Thank you.
tarde, tienen el culo después de más distancia. ¡Urse, cabrón, hombre, hombre! ¿Arrodillado? Bueno. ¡Sope! Okay, oh.
These tapes bring out views of the people who are subjected to these pressures, rather than the point of view of those who are doing the oppressing and presenting what you might say would be the official point of view. This, to me, brings a new view, another view of what's involved here, which I must confess I didn't have before.
Get ready. In. Out. Get ready. In. That's where we got up to. It's in.
Mm-hmm.